Okay, hello everyone. So today I'm going to go over November 2019 IB Physics Higher Level Paper 1. As you know, it's a 40 mark paper, 40 MCQs, and here is the distribution of topics. We have roughly 25 questions from topics 1 to 8, and we have an additional 14 MCQs from topics 9 to 12, the higher level topics, and we have one nature of science question. So let's get started. So which quantity has the fundamental SI units of that? Well, my approach here would be to simply work out the unit in fundamental SI units for each quantity. So energy we know is measured in joules, which per definition is 1 newton times 1 meter. 1 newton per definition is 1 kilogram times meters per second squared. Mass times acceleration, so it's not going to be this one because the meters combine to meters squared and not meters to the negative one. What about force? Well, definitely not. We just talked about Newton being defined in this way, so it's not that one either. What about momentum? That's mass times velocity, so kilogram times meters per second, and it's not that one either, so it has to be this one. And in an exam situation, of course, you would just move on, I guess, but let's just check that it really is pressure. So pressure is force per area, so that's newtons per square meter. Newtons is kilograms times meters per second squared times meters to the negative 2, and yes, that does give us meters to the negative 1 per second squared. Okay, so this is question on derived units, which I would say is topic 1. Okay, question 2. Two forces act along a straight line on an object that is initially at rest. One force is constant, the second force is in the opposite direction and proportional to the velocity. Okay, so you should be thinking terminal velocity, you should be thinking something falling through the air. Because normally we are looking at this in the vertical direction, where weight, the force of gravity, is the constant force, and the varying force is air resistance that depends on the velocity of the object. So this is really a question about terminal velocity. So we're in topic 2. And we can see that the first two answers can say, they start off by saying the acceleration increases from zero. So it's definitely not going to increase from zero, because initially there is an acceleration when there's only the constant force acting on it. So what about the velocity? Does it increase from zero to a maximum value? That's what we normally see with terminal velocity. Doesn't suddenly start to decrease. So when the varying force it is going to increase, and it reaches a magnitude that balances out the constant force, and then it stops accelerating, zero net force, and the velocity will just remain constant and maximum. So that's that. Okay, question 3 is about a ball falling from rest, no air resistance this time, and the position is determined at 1 second intervals from the instant at which it's released. What are the distances in meters traveled by the center of the ball during each second, each in bowl? So pay good attention to that. So it's like how far does it travel during the first second, and during the second second, and during the third second, and so on. So this is really a SUVAT question, where you have to remember that, okay, falling from rest, no air resistance, we know that we can use S equals half GT squared for that, and G being roughly 10, so we get 5T squared. And then we can see, of course, well, you know, when time is 1, the first second, of course, we get 5, so that doesn't rule anything out. Then in the second second, so after 2 seconds, you plug in 2, you get 5 times 2 squared, 5 times 4, which is 20 meters. But that means, since it already traveled 5 meters in the first second, it's traveled 15 meters in the second second. And that's only B that contains that answer. So, and you can check that the other numbers, they also fit. So that's question 3. Okay, question four. We are throwing an object from a cliff at an angle to the horizontal. And this is, of course, projectile motion that we're looking at. So projectile motion, topic two, and the situation normally looks something like this. We have an object being projected at an angle to the horizontal, and it will take a nice parabolic trajectory. That wasn't a very nice parabola. Let's quickly fix that. Something like that. Okay, and they're telling us we know three quantities. We know the horizontal component of the initial velocity, we know the initial angle, we know the height of the cliff. Okay, now maybe you can remember that in order to get the range, right, they're asking for this range, or what quantities must be known in order to calculate that. So typically we need the horizontal component of the initial velocity, which is constant all the time, and then we need the time of flight. So basically, how long is it flying for, and then we just use the horizontal component to get the range. So we definitely need the horizontal component. We also need the height of the cliff to get the time of flight. Now, what about the initial angle? Well, we actually need to know if it's sort of being projected upwards or downwards. So you can imagine that that it was projected downwards with the same angle, just sort of downwards from the horizontal. Then it would have the same horizontal component, but of course the time of flight would be shorter because it's being projected downwards and not upwards. So we kind of also need to know the initial angle between the velocity, and therefore we need to know all three. So slightly tricky, a lot of thinking in that question. Okay, question five is a straightforward motion graph question. We have acceleration versus time, and they're asking about the change in velocity. And when we have an acceleration graph, we know that the change in velocity is the area under the acceleration graph. So this is area under a acceleration versus time graph, which is delta v. So, and it's from 0 seconds to 6 seconds, right? So we basically need to just work out these areas. Let me see. Was it at rest? Well, we don't need to know that. It's just the change in velocity. Just need to know the delta v, which is the area. So 1 times 2 is 2 meters per second there. And what about this one over here? Well, let's use the trapezium formula, shall we? 1 half. And then one parallel side is 1 long. This one, the other parallel side is 3 long. At that, times 1 half times the height, which is 4 seconds. So what's that? That's 16 divided by 2, that's 8. So we get 10 meters per second. There you go. Okay, so question 6. We have a nuclear particle has an energy of 10 to the 8 eV. And then a grain of sand has a mass of 32 milligrams. What speed must the grain of sand have? Okay, so this seems sort of a bit strange, this question. We're in topic 7 with a nuclear particle, but we also have kinetic energy. We have milligrams in EV and millimeters per second. It's kind of like a topic 1 unit question. We're going to have powers of 10 involved, but it's also mechanics and maybe a tiny bit of topic 7. So it's a mix of everything. But I'll sort of count it as a topic 2 question, I guess. We have kinetic energy involved here. So let's write it up. We have kinetic energy, half mv squared, and that has to be equal to the energy of 10 to the 8 eV. So 10 to the 8 eV. Now 1 eV is 1.6 10 to the negative 19 joule. The mass is 32 milligrams. Let's write that as 16 milligrams multiplied by a half. And milli is, of course, 10 to the negative 3. Then I get it in grams, but I really want it in kilograms. So why don't we write that as 16 10 to the negative 6 kilograms times v squared. And that is, let's combine the powers of 10 over here. I'm going to get 1.6 10 to the negative 11. So we can isolate v squared. Let me just write that up carefully. You don't want to make a mistake here. And you can see, okay, 1.6 over 16. Luckily, those numbers cancel out nicely. Remember, we don't have a calculator. So 1.6 over 16 is 10 to the negative 1. So basically, we have 10 to the negative 6. And that's going to come out in meters squared per second squared. Take the square root. We end up with 10 to the negative 3 meters per second, which is 1 millimeter per second. So that was really, I would say, powers of 10 question, which would put it in topic 1, but it's also kinetic energy. It's also a tiny bit of topic 7 or topic 5, but okay, doesn't really matter. I kind of like these questions where they mix things up. There you go. Okay, so question 7, the tension in a horizontal spring is directly proportional to the extension of the spring. The energy stored is E when it's extended by X. What is the work done by the spring when its extension changes from X to X quarters? Okay, so the most important thing to remember is we have elastic potential energy is half kx squared. Or really, we just need to know that the elastic potential energy is proportional to the extension squared. So that means that if the extension is 1/4 of x, then the energy is going to be 1/16 of the energy. So we really have, later on, E prime, we only have 1/16 of the previous energy. So we went from having an amount of energy E to having only 1/16 of E, which means that there's been a change in energy, which is E minus 1 over 16 E, which is 15/16 E. And that's energy that the spring has lost. So that's really the work done by the spring, acting on whatever it is attached to. So it's D, and let's label this as an elastic energy question. That is topic 2. Okay, finally, we're moving on to topic 3. We have a mass of water that's at that temperature. and we are told that we are adding some ice at its melting point. Okay, so the melting point of ice is 0 degrees Celsius, which is 273 Kelvin. That's added to the water to reduce the water temperature to the freezing point. So we want to reduce the temperature of the water to 0 degrees Celsius, 273 Kelvin. So we want it to go from 290 Kelvin to 273 Kelvin. So we need to take away some energy from the water. And let's write down how much energy that is. It's basically mC, and then what's the change in temperature from 290 to 273 is 70 Kelvin. So we have that delta T. Okay, so mC delta T, that's the energy needs to be taken out of the liquid water. And where's that energy going? Well, it's going into melting the ice. And we want to find the minimum mass of ice that is required. So basically, this has to be equal to the latent heat. So the amount of energy required to melt a certain mass of ice, say the mass is m prime, and we know the specific latent heat of fusion for ice is L, so m prime L, that's the amount of energy required to melt the ice. Those two energies have to be equal, so this is really calorimetry, a calorimetry question, calorimetry, topic 3. And we can now just solve for the mass of ice. And is that just straightforward? Yeah, okay, 17 and then divided by L. There you go, mC 17 L, that's an A. Okay, question 9. Ideal gas, so this is under which conditions of pressure and density will a real gas approximate to an ideal gas? So it's the ideal versus real gas idea. And we know the density has to be low, pressures has to be low, Kelvin temperatures have to be relatively high. So here we're just looking at pressure and density. So low density, don't want the particles too close to each other for those intermolecular forces to kick in. And we also want the pressure to be low for the same reasons. So D is the correct answer. Okay, question 10. Two flasks connected with a tube of negligible volume. So in this situation, we have two equal pressures because they're connected, so the pressure can equalize. So we can start writing up the, this is about the ideal law, ideal gas equation. We have to use that. So I'm going to write up that the pressure in P is the number of particles in P times K times the temperature in P. And you know, this is one divided by the volume of P. That's one version of the ideal gas law. Remember, we have those two versions. We have PV nRT, we have PV big NKT, two versions. Okay, and then the pressure is going to be equal in Q, which has a different number of particles. K is the same, has a different temperature, has a different volume. Okay, but we start with this equation. And we notice that it says the volume of P is twice that of Q, so I can write 2VQ. So VQ cancels out. Temperature P and Q, they're in a ratio 1 to 2, and they're an absolute temperature. They're given in Kelvin, so that's okay. K cancels out. And then we can sort of rearrange that to NP over NQ is 2 times 2, get 4. And you know, this is the ratio of the number of particles, and because it's the same gas, then we know that the mass is proportional to the number of particles. So this is also going to be the ratio of the masses. So it's a C. Okay, question 11. We have moved into waves, topic 4, and this is a transverse wave moving through a medium. The graph is showing what the wave looks like at a given instant. Okay, so it's like a picture of a rope, say. And we know the frequency of the wave, we know the speed of the wave, and then what is correct for this wave. Okay, so are x and y in phase? Clearly not, because when x is up here, y is down there, so they're actually completely out of phase. Phase difference is pi. Okay, so that's not right. And the velocity of the particle at x is at a maximum. That is also incorrect because we know this particle, all the particles sort of at one particular distance, they are moving up and down in simple harmonic motion. And we know that when a particle is furthest away from the equilibrium in simple harmonic motion, then they have zero velocity. It's when they whiz past the equilibrium point that they have the maximum velocity. So that's also incorrect. Horizontal distance between x and y is 3 meters. Let's leave that one alone for now because that's going to be the right answer. D, the velocity of the particle is 100 meters per second. The velocity of the particle at y. Well, no, because y is also at its maximum displacement in its simple harmonic motion, so the velocity should be zero. So it has to be c. Let's just double check that, because you can see from x to z, we haven't moved completely one wavelength. Okay, we're sort of 3/4 of a wavelength, because if we go from x to this point, that's 1/4. X to y is half a wavelength. X to z is 3/4 of a wavelength. So let's work out what the wavelength is, and we'll use the wave equation for that, because we know that the wave equation says that wave speed is frequency times wavelength. So wavelength is the speed of the wave that we have over the frequency. Hertz is per second, so we're going to get 4 meters. And then 3/4 of that is 3 meters. So C is correct. Okay, question 12, looking at a graph again of some wave motion. Here we are looking at the displacement of a single particle in a traveling wave. So basically, sort of simple harmonic motion here, where we're focusing on the behavior, the motion of one particle going up and down. Like in the previous problem, say you're looking at the particle at x, it's going up and down, so it's moving like this. A displacement in millionths of a meter, notice the powers of 10 on the axes, and what are the frequency and amplitude for the oscillation? Okay, so frequency we can get from the period, right? So why don't we read off the period is 20, 10 to the negative 6, that's microseconds, right? So the frequency is 1 over 10, it's 1 over 20 times that. It's going to come out in hertz, so you just need to work with your powers of 10. So this is like 1 over 20, 10 to the 6. We know 1 over 20 is 0.05 times 10 to the 6, and that's if, okay, so you can see in the problem they want the frequency in kilohertz, this is in hertz. So let's try and convert that to kilohertz, we're going to get 50 kilohertz, 10 to the 3 hertz, right? I'm just playing around with the powers of 10 here so that I can get kilohertz, so 50 is the correct answer. Okay, and then the amplitude, that's pretty easy to read off, right? That the amplitude is the distance from equilibrium to maximum displacement, and that's 2 micrometers. Again, 10 to the negative 6 is micrometers, so C is the correct answer. Okay, just to make a comment about the previous question, that was really sort of about F equals 1 over T. There was also some power of 10 knowledge in there as well. Okay, next question, polarized light. So this is about polarization. And this one is relatively easy. Let's see. So unpolarized light is incident on starts at x, and then they're arranged so that the light emerging from y has a maximum intensity. So in the beginning, their transmission axes are parallel. So that so we get maximum intensity on the other side of y. X is fixed, now y is rotated, and then when do we get maximum intensity again, right? So I hope you can imagine that if the angle turns 180 degrees, then we're going to get another maximum intensity, because when you turn 90 degrees, you're going to block all the light. So that's zero, and you have to keep on turning to 180 degrees to get all the light through again. And then you have to again turn 180 degrees, and again 180 degrees. So every time you turn 180 degrees, you get maximum intensity again. So that was a relatively easy one. Okay, number 14. A pipe of length 0.6 meters filled with a gas closed at one end. So this is a half open pipe situation, and of course we're talking about standing waves. Still a topic 4. And speed of sound is 300. Okay, so the length of the pipe is 0.6 meters. Now, frequency is the first two harmonics. Now let's look at the first harmonic. What does that look like? Well, we have antinode and the opening, and we have a node at the other end. And this is 1/4 of a wavelength, so that the wavelength of that first harmonic is going to be 4 times the tube length, so that's 2.4 meters. And to get the frequency of that, we simply take the speed over the wavelength, and then you have to work that out. And of course, you have no calculator, right? So, you know, do that carefully, and, you know, I'm just trying to simplify this down to something that I recognize very easily, and if I do this, then I can see, oh, times 5, then I'm going to get 125 hertz. Okay, so that's the first one. So it's either A or B, it's not C or D. And then remember that when we have a half open tube, higher harmonics are odd multiples of the first harmonic, because the next harmonic looks like this, where we introduce a node and we still have antinode at the opening, so we're going to get something like that, which is we're looking at 3/4 of the wavelength instead of 1/4 of the wavelength before, so the factor 3 get, becomes introduced. So we have to multiply that by 3 to get the next harmonic, and that's 375. Okay, so this is, we've moved into topic 5 now, no more topic 4. We have a negatively charged particle in a uniform gravitational field positioned midway between those two charge conducting plates. Okay, it's positioned. Potential difference is adjusted until the particle is held at rest. Okay, so if we draw the particle, we have the weight due to the gravitational field going down, and then we have an electric force, of course, balancing that out. Let's call that QE. And what change will cause the particle to accelerate downwards? We need gravity to be stronger. Basically, we need to weaken the electric field, and we're, you know, decreasing the charge. Well, that would weaken it, wouldn't it? If I decrease the charge, if Q gets smaller, we don't change anything else, then of course it's going to go downwards. So A is already correct, right? We could move on, but let's just check the other one, the other ones, and they are talking about the separation, the distance between the plates, the length of the plates, and so on, potential difference. So this is kind of a high-level question where we have to remember that the electric field between two charged metal plates is given as the potential difference divided by the distance between the plates. And then you can see if you were to decrease the separation between the plates, then you are actually increasing the electric field, so that wouldn't help. Increasing the length of the plates doesn't matter, because we're just talking about the electric field is uniform between these plates, and we're sort of in the middle of the plate, so that won't change anything. And then increasing the potential difference, of course, increases V, so it increases E again, and it goes upwards. So this is sort of the electric force between metal plates question, mainly higher level. Even though you know, an SL student could already deduce that A is the correct answer, but when they're talking about E being V over D, that's a higher level formula. Okay, still topic 5, but now electric circuits. We have a 24 volt power supply and then another power supply as shown. No internal resistances. What is the magnitude of P for the ammeter to be zero? Okay, so let's first look at the potential drops across the resistors. Now the resistors are in a ratio 9 to 3, that's 3 to 1. So we know that the voltage from 24 is going to be divided up in the same ratio, 3 to 1. So that's going to be 6 volts against 18 volts, right? So I know that the voltage drop due to the 24 volt power supply is 6 volts across the 3 ohm resistor. If we want the current through A to be zero, then P has to, you know, balance that potential drop, has to sort of balance that electron push. So that's why we can see that it has to be 6 volts. Preventing electrons from going through the ammeter. Yeah, and just to also put a label on this question, I would just call this simple circuits, because we are just dealing with sort of the fundamental idea between sort of EMF and voltage drops and currents. All right, next question, still topic 5. Wire has an electric current placed in a magnetic field, but I don't know, what's the direction of F? In a direction determined by I only, so that's not correct, because it's also determined by the direction of B, and it's therefore also not answer B here, because it's also determined by the direction of the current. Is it in the plane containing I and B? No, it's in the direction is perpendicular to the plane containing the current and the magnetic field. So D is the correct answer, and that is simply something we need to know, the magnetic force direction. Okay, Now we're looking at circular motion, uniform circular motion, so that's topic six we've moved into. And we have to find an expression for tan theta. So I would draw a nice free body diagram. We have force of gravity pointing downwards, and we know that we have a tension force going up along the string. Now we know that since it's moving in a horizontal circle, it has a constant angular speed, then we know that it has to have a centripetal force. That is the horizontal component of the tension. So that's m r omega squared. So r omega squared is the centripetal acceleration expressed in omega. So, you know, remember that we have, you know, often students only remember v squared over r, but it's also r omega squared, using the definition that v is r omega. Well, it's not definition, that's just a fact. And v and omega, they're related to each other in this way. So we can see that the angle theta is also in this little triangle. So tan theta is the opposite mr omega squared divided by the adjacent, which is mg, because the vertical component of the tension force is balanced out by the weight, and then we get the first one, a. So this is, I would say, let's just call it centripetal force, which means it's a uniform circular motion question. Okay, question 19. Now we're in topic 7, so there was only one question on topic 6 there. And we're looking at some decays. And then we have to determine which statement is correct. So I would start off by maybe labeling the X. You can give it a mass number A and an atomic number Z. And then we can see when it decays with an alpha particle, then we end up with A minus 4P, Z minus 2. And then with a beta minus, what happens? Mass number is the same, but our proton number increases by 1 like that, and that's, by the way, Q. Let's call that Q. Okay, and then the second line is beta minus, which is adding 1 proton. And then alpha is, that was A. Didn't change the mass number, but now we change the mass number. And we also change the atomic number down by 2, and that's S. Okay, so if you look at like Q and S, they're actually exactly the same isotope. So they're not different isotopes, and they're the same element, same isotope. So it's not A. Mass numbers of X and R are the same. That's definitely correct. Let's see, mass number. That's A, right? So X and R, they have the same mass number, good. And then we don't even need to bother with the other ones. They're going to be wrong. You can double check that. So that's radioactive decay. Okay, still topic 7, question 20. And we are looking at the ratio of charge to mass. We have to compare like a proton, an electron, and an alpha particle. So, and we have to find the, the smallest and the largest charge to mass ratio, okay? Okay, so let's just write down, well, the proton charge is E, mass of the proton is MP. The electron charge is E, mass is the mass of the electron, which is much lighter than the proton, is around 2,000 times lighter. So this ratio is actually 2,000 times greater than the proton's ratio. The alpha has a charge of 2e, and it has roughly a mass of 4 protons. You know, it's 2 protons, 2 neutrons, sort of comparable mass size, and that is 1/2 e/mp. So we can see that 2,000 e/mp, that's the largest charge to mass ratio, that's the electron, and then the smallest charge to mass ratio is the alpha particle. So A is the correct answer. And this is, what should we call this? This is a Q over M question from topic 5. Okay, gamma radiation, again, topic 7, is deflected by a magnetic field? No, because it's not charged. It affects a photographic plate? Yes, it's photons, and they can affect a photographic plate. So we can stop and move on, but let's just check. Originates in the electron cloud outside a nucleus? No, gamma radiation originates inside the nucleus. And it's deflected by an electric field? No, it's not charged. So yes, it's that. And let's just say this is about gamma radiation. You need to remember the nature of the different types of radiation. Okay, so question 22 is a nature of science question. So, you know, it's not directly about something in the course syllabus. It's more like in sort of a big picture idea. And they're asking about the equations of motion for uniform acceleration, the Suvat equations, right? And do they apply to all accelerations? No, they don't. The acceleration has to be constant. They cannot be proved mathematically. No, they can be proven mathematically because there is a rigorous mathematical relationship between position, velocity, and acceleration. And the Suvat equations are really just us using math. You know, we have a definition of what velocity is and a definition of what acceleration is, and then we can use calculus to get the mathematical relationship that connects those quantities. Does it relate force to other quantities in mechanics? No, that is what F equals ma does. Okay, so the Suvat equations on their own, they don't contain F equals ma. So the Suvat equations are just describing the motion, but they're not sort of explaining it and relating it to force. And I also just want to say that F equals ma can also not be proven mathematically. F equals ma is a law of nature. It happens to be that, you know, force as a separate quantity is related to acceleration and mass in this particular way, and that's not something you can prove mathematically. This is just a fact about the world. So, yes, the equations of motion were developed through observing the natural world, like all science was really developed by observing the natural world. And so noticing that, you know, position, velocity, and acceleration, they have these, they're related to each other in this way, and that is how they were sort of developed. We observed the natural world and came up with this. All right, question 23. What are the units of specific energy and energy density? So we're in topic 8 now, by the way. And you just have to remember that specific energy is energy per unit mass. So that's joules per kilo. I always relate it to specific heat capacity, which is also energy per temperature per unit mass. And energy density is energy per volume. So that is a, what should we call it? Let's just write these energies, right? So it's energy in topic 8. That's what this is about. Okay, so topic 8, nuclear. What is the function of the moderator? You know, classic question. They ask about the moderator so often. We want to decrease the kinetic energy from the fission reactions. Yes, we do. We want to moderate their energies, their speeds, right? Slow those neutrons down. We don't want to increase it. We don't want to decrease the overall number of neutrons. We don't want to increase. Nope, so it's A. And that's an easy one. Moderator question. Topic 8, nuclear power. Okay, question 25 is about the albedo. So you need to remember the definition of the albedo. That if it's 0.1, it simply means that 10% of the radiation that is incident on the moon is reflected by its surface. So that's what C says, right? So the albedo is the ratio between the reflected power energy intensity over the total incoming power energy intensity, whatever. So, yeah. Okay, so now we're in topic 9, higher level stuff only. We're looking at simple harmonic motion, amplitude is x naught. And it says when the displacement is that, the speed is that. What is the speed when the displacement is x naught, the maximum amplitude? Kind of like a trick question. We know that when the particle is at its maximum displacement, the amplitude, then the speed is zero. So that is a simple harmonic motion question. Okay, 27 is a diffraction question. We have light of a certain frequency incident on a single slit formed a diffraction pattern. So we have to remember, of course, that we have this important equation that gives us the angle from the central maximum to the first minimum in terms of the wavelength and the slit width. Okay, and we know that angle initially is 2.5 10 to the negative 3 radian. Now the frequency has changed, and what is the angle? Okay, so angle is proportional to the wavelength, but they're changing the frequency here. So let's just remember that, of course, wavelength and frequency are inversely proportional. So we know that the angle is going to be proportional to the inversely proportional to the frequency. So the second angle, the ratio of the second angle to the first angle is going to be the inverse ratio of the frequencies. First frequency was 500 terahertz, 750 terahertz, so this is 2 over 3. So the second angle is 2/3 of that first angle. And okay, 3, 2.4 is 0.8, 2 times 0.8 is 1.6, 10 to the negative 3, a diffraction. Okay, we're looking at a diffraction grating here. So don't forget the diffraction formula, which basically says that we know that the nth order maximum is going to appear at this angle. So we have sort of the diffraction formula. You know, d, the spacing between the lines, times sine of the angle equals to n times the wavelength. Okay, so we get constructive interference at integer multiples of the wavelength, and this equation encompasses all that. So we're looking at the angle between the 2 second order maxima. We also know that the diffraction grating spacing d is 3 lambda. So let's write something down. So we have 3 lambda. Okay, and we are looking at the second order maximum. So let me just put n equals to 2. Lambda cancels out. I get 2/3 equals to sine theta. So theta is sine inverse of 2 over 3. But that is, you know, the angle to one side. That's the angle to the second order maximum from the middle. Okay, so that angle is this angle, but we want the angle between the 2 second order maxima. So there's also a second order maxima going in the opposite direction, minus 2, and then we want this angle, and that's of course 2 times that angle. So it's C. Okay, question 29 is a Doppler effect question. And we can see we have the sea waves moving at a constant speed towards a beach, and they have a frequency of 0.1 hertz relative to the beach. The girl is moving in the sea, and she experiences a higher frequency, 0.4 hertz. So she's basically moving towards the waves, so she's going outwards from the beach. It's a moving observer. She's the observer. She's moving, and she's moving towards the waves. So you go to your data booklet and you look at the moving observer formula, which says f prime is f, and then there's a v, and there's a plus or a minus u naught v. And we have to use the positive sign because we have the girl is measuring a higher frequency. So f prime, the observed frequency, has to be higher, so we're using the plus like that. And we know f prime is 0.4, divide by f, which is 0.1, and that's going to be v plus u naught, and v is 2, speed of the wave, relative to the beach. So we get this, so we get that's 4 times 2, that's 8, 2 plus u naught, so we get 6. So speed of the surfboard relative to the beach is going to be 6. And the direction of motion of surfboard, it's moving away from the beach. There you go. Okay, question 30, gravitational potential. So don't forget that V is minus Gm over R. And we are here, R above the surface of a spherical planet of radius R. So we're basically at 2R, right? So really, the V is 2R. And then what is the gravitational potential at a distance 2R above the surface? So, well, that is going to be minus Gm over 3R. But of course, what is that in terms of V? Well, that is going to be 2/3 of what we had before, right? Because the 2 cancels out and you get that. So the gravitational potential is 2/3 of V. 2/3 of V. So that's D. That's one way of doing it. The other way is knowing that, okay, potential is inversely proportional with the radius. We are going from 2R away from the center to 3R away from the center, and that's a factor 3 over 2 that we've applied. And since, so the radius has increased by a factor 3 over 2, but since potential is inversely proportional to distance, then it becomes a factor 2 over 3 smaller. So that's 2/3 of V. So that is gravitational potential. Topic 10. We are now in topic 10, moved away from topic 9. Okay, so now we are looking at 2 point charges, and the force is F when the separation is X. What happens to the force when the separation is increased to 3x? So distance between them increases by a factor 3. Well, maybe you can remember Coulomb's law, of course, is inversely proportional to distance squared, just like Newton's universal law of gravity. So if the distance increases by a factor 3, the force decreases by a factor 3 squared, which is 1/9, so it's C. So this is kind of a topic 5 question. I was waiting for a topic 10 question, but this is really just Coulomb's law, which belongs to topic 5 and is something a standard level student could have done. Okay, so an electron enters a uniform electric field, so constant field strength with a velocity. So that's going to experience a constant electric force pointing in the direction, or actually opposite to the direction of the E field, because it's a negative charge. But the question is really about what is the path of the electron. Now, it's going to be parabolic because the analogy to this is just throwing a stone in a gravitational field, that you have a constant gravitational field. So there's a constant acceleration on the object, and that causes a parabolic trajectory, just like in projectile motion. So this is really about a charge moving in a uniform electric field. Okay, so now we are moving into topic 11, which we haven't covered in class yet, but let me nevertheless just still solve this one. So we have 2 plane coils parallel to each other, have common axis, constant direct current in Y. You can see the current in Y. So that current, if I use my right-hand thumb rule, the current is going like this, and that's going to create a B field that is going into the loop. Okay, now X is first moved towards Y, so that means the magnetic flux is going to be increasing through X from right to left, and X wants to oppose that increase in magnetic flux, so X is going to generate, or a current is going to be generated that opposes the change in magnetic flux. So we want the B field to go to the right through X, and that's going to give us a current that is flowing in this direction, and that is going to be opposite, okay, to Y. And then And then it's going to be now moving away from y. And when it moves away from y, then it, you know, it's now used to having a flux going through it from right to left. And as you remove it away from y, then it's losing magnetic flux. It wants to maintain that flux. So it's going to generate a current that, of course, goes in this opposite direction to what it did before. And that is the same direction as in y. So that's that. And this is called Lenz's law. That's something we'll be covering after your mock exam. So don't worry about that question now. Okay, this question is also topic 11. This question is on Faraday's law. Again, something that we haven't covered yet. I'll do that after the mocks, but let me just write it down. It's the induced EMF is proportional to the rate of change of magnetic flux. So we know that we look at how the magnetic flux is changing, and where it changes the most, that's where it has, you know, the steepest tangent to its curve, that is where we get the maximally induced EMF. So here we have the largest negative slope, and that corresponds to the largest positive induced EMF. So that looks right, whereas all the others, they are wrong. So that's something we'll be covering after the mocks again. So let's write, we can say the maximum d phi dt, and it's also negative, so we get a negative negative, a positive EMF. Okay, question 35 is about capacitors. Again, topic 11. So we have a capacitor with a capacitance that is storing a certain amount of charge. Well, given that, we can work out the kind of the EMF, the maximum voltage that this capacitor can supply. That's Q over C, so that's 15 microcoulombs over 1 microfarad. Okay, so what we get from that is 15 volts. The micros cancel out and capacitance, coulomb over farad gives us volt. Okay, and then we know that when we discharge it through a resistor, the maximum current is going to be right in the beginning when the capacitor is supplying the maximum voltage. So we can just use Ohm's first law or just the resistance definition. I'd rather call it current is voltage over resistance, so 15 volts over 25 ohm. And that gives us 3 over 5, which is 0.6 amps C. Okay, and let's also just put a label on question 35, and that is capacitors. Okay, question 36 is one of these diode bridge rectifications. So diode rectification, that's topic 11. This is about taking alternating current and trying to turn it into a more direct current. And let's see. So we have one of these bridges, and when P conducts, okay, then the current has to be flowing in this direction. And that is, of course, when current is flowing from N up to this junction, and then it has to flow through R, and then it can't flow through Q, so it flows across the resistor, flows through P, and back to M. So it's correct that when P conducts, Q does not conduct, correct. Okay, and then the other way is when M is positive and we have current flowing into this junction, then Q conducts and can't go through R, so it runs again from right to left. We have sort of rectified the current, so the resistor gets current flowing from the same direction, goes back through S and back to N. So when S conducts, neither P nor R conducts, correct. The direction of conventional current in the resistor is from left to right. No, it was from right to left in both cases, so that's wrong. So only 1 and 2 are correct. And that's diode rectification, topic 11. It's not going to be on the mock exam. Okay, question 37 is topic 12 now, quantum mechanics. You have a low energy electron in a high potential barrier. What's the process by which it can escape? Quantum tunneling. That's an easy one, I would say. Barrier climbing. That's not a proper scientific term in quantum mechanics. So yeah, it's tunneling. Okay, we have a question here about photons. We are looking at a monochromatic beam of them. And monochromatic is same wavelength, of course, same frequency. And we're not changing the frequency, but the intensity is doubled. So we're just getting more photons, but all the photons have the same energy because the energy of a photon is only proportional to the wavelength of the electromagnetic radiation. So that's what this question really is about. So if there's no change in frequency, there's also no change in energy, no change in momentum, because the momentum of a photon is indeed just directly proportional to its energy. So yeah, photon, the momentum doesn't change. Okay, so here we have a question about electrons, the behavior of electrons. So electron and the question is, which observations above are evidence that the electron behaves as a particle? We know that electrons, they behave both as a wave and a particle. That's the wave-particle duality. It all depends on what in which context we are observing the electrons. So electron emission as a result of the photoelectric effect, that's definitely, we are thinking of electrons as small particles interacting with particles of light, photons. So yeah, they're a particle. Electron diffraction as an electron interacts with an atom. So we know that diffraction is a wave phenomenon. And yes, electrons, they can diffract as they pass through crystals. But that's more a property of the electron wave rather than it being a particle. So that's not going to count. But the emission of radio waves as a result of electrons oscillating in a conductor, well, emission of radio waves, yeah, so when electrons as small charged particles, as they oscillate, move up and down, then the electric field will also that they generate is also oscillating, and they in that way they generate electromagnetic waves that propagate outwards. So that's also us thinking of the electron as a little charged particle that can move up and down. So that's also electrons behaving as small particles. So I'd say 1 and 3. Okay, the last question is topic 12, nuclear physics. So we're looking at the formula for radioactive decays and so on. And this is sort of kind of almost like a trick question. We have, we're looking at the decay law, radioactive decay law, that N atoms at a given time T is the initial amount of atoms times e to the negative lambda t. And lambda, the decay constant, you could get it from the half-life and so on. But then they're asking about the decay rate. The decay rate is the activity, the rate of decay. How many disintegrations per unit time? And what is that proportional to? It is always proportional to the number of radioactive nuclei left over. So it is simply A, that's the correct answer. And we're done. Hooray.